Talk Show.
Recorded live.
Greetings and welcome to Nothing But the Truth on December 11th, 2014. If you hear a pounding noise, it's coming down in cats and dogs, raining cats and dogs on the Oregon coast here. Anyway, I'm sitting in for Michael tonight because Michael's having some internet problems connection and we couldn't clear it up before the broadcast. So tonight's broadcast, Tom Fresh of Inquisition Update is going to be speaking on blasphemy. And there's only one place to get the definition for the word blasphemy, and that's from God's Word, the Bible. With that, welcome to the broadcast, Tom.
Yes, good evening, Walt, and my condolences to Michael Adams. I'm certainly familiar with internet connection problems. It's a shame to have to sit in the audience and listen to your own program because you can't participate, but hopefully he'll get his internet connection problems fixed and we'll be able to understand him again. And thank you, Walt, for setting in for him so we can continue this program. Tonight, I've been invited by Michael Adams to come and define blasphemy and to talk about blasphemy and to show you how the grand blasphemer of all the earth has blasphemed the name of Almighty God and His throne and His people. And I'm sure the listeners will find this program interesting. Now, as I was speaking to Walt before the program, I said that most Christian people on the street, if you were to ask them to define blasphemy, you'd hear something like this. Well, blasphemy is using the name of Jesus Christ as a curse word. Okay, and anything more than that, you wouldn't hear. I mean, it's just generally, almost universally believed that using Jesus' name as though it were a curse is blasphemy. And even though that's true, it's such a narrow understanding of what blasphemy is that it needs to be talked about. People need to understand the biblical definition of blasphemy. Now, somebody's going to misquote me and say that Tom says it's not blasphemy to use Jesus' name as a curse, as in, well, Jesus Christ. You've heard it all over the world. You've heard it on television and everywhere else. Yes, indeed, it's blasphemous to use Jesus' name as a curse word. Jesus is not a curse to God's people, and we ought not to use his name in such fashion. So with that out of the way, let's talk now about the biblical definition of blasphemy. You'll find it quite different than the general definition as believed by Christians today. The Bible itself defines its own terms. I mean, you can go to a dictionary, or you can go to a newspaper, or you can go to a college or a university and get their definition of blasphemy, but for our discussions, for our purposes, the Bible and the Bible alone defines blasphemy. And for that, we go to John chapter 10 and verse 33. Now, in this case, Jesus had just healed a man and said to the man, "Thy sins be forgiven thee." In other words, Jesus forgave his sins. And as a result, the religious leaders of the day who saw and heard what Jesus said, "Thy sins be forgiven thee," they picked up stones to stone Jesus. Now, under the Jewish law, anyone who blasphemed the name of God was to be stoned. And they gathered up stones to stone Jesus because, according to them, he blasphemed. Now listen to what Jesus said that they interpret to be blasphemy. John chapter 10, verse 33, quote, "The Jews answered him, saying, For a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy. And because that thou, being a man, makest thyself God. Now let me say it in plain English. The Jews answered him, saying, we're not stoning you because you do good works. We're stoning you because you blasphemed. Because you, being a man, make yourself to be God. In other words, you put yourself in God's place. You attributed to yourself the attributes, the power, the prerogative, the legal jurisdiction of God yourself when you say to the man, thy sins be forgiven thee. In other words, they didn't realize that Jesus was God and that he was proclaiming himself to be God and proving himself to be God when he said to the man, thy sins be forgiven thee. Now, another question I have to ask is, what is greater? For the creator of all heaven and earth, the one who formed man from the dust of the ground, and the one who died for his sins to redeem him to God, what is greater? For the God that made man from the dust of the ground to heal his body? Or is it greater for him to say, thy sins be forgiven thee? First of all, it didn't take much effort for God to form man from the dust of the ground. The Bible records that account. But I maintain to you that it took far greater power for Jesus to say, thy sins be forgiven ye. First of all, Jesus had to live a sinless life. He had to be qualified to take upon himself the sins of the whole world. He had to suffer the persecution and the crucifixion that took his life. He had to suffer the beatings, the scourgings, the plucking out of his beard, and all of the abuses that were inflicted upon him as leading up to the crucifixion, that God himself had to become a man and to bear upon his body all of our sins and then take the punishment that was owed to us. He does forgive sins. That is his office. That is his prerogative. That is his power. And it's not shared by anyone else in the universe. That is his and his alone. And yet, not realizing who he was, the religious leaders of the day, the Jews, took up stones to stone him for blasphemy, for saying in effect, when he forgave the man his sins, I am God. This is my office. This is the very reason for which I came to the earth, to forgive men their sins. And yet they took up stones to stone him, not because he healed a man, not because he did good works, but because he arrogated to himself the prerogative, the power, the office of God himself. They were wrong. Jesus was the Messiah. Jesus was God in the flesh, the express image of the Father. And so the Jews got it wrong. And many Christians have it wrong, too. And now we'll talk about how it is that the Christians have it wrong. Here is some quotes. Here are, rather, some quotes from official papal documents, Roman Catholic Church literature, Protestant literature, recording examples or quotes from popes, and Roman Catholic prelates such as bishops and archbishops and priests about the office of the papacy, about the prerogatives of the papacy, about the power of the papacy. And you'll find in each and every one the words of blasphemy. The first quote comes from the Catholic National. It's a Roman Catholic publication. This quote was printed in the July 1895 issue. Quote, listen carefully, with the new understanding of what blasphemy is, putting oneself in the position of God, or arrogating to oneself the power and the prerogative and the office of God. Here's what is said. Quote, the Pope is not only the representative of Jesus Christ, he is Jesus Christ himself, hidden under the veil of flesh. Unquote. I'll read it again. The Pope is not only the representative of Jesus Christ, he is Jesus Christ himself, hidden under the veil of flesh. Here's another quote, this from Pope Leo XIII's encyclical letter dated June the 20th, 1894. Quote, we hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty, unquote. Who is the we he was speaking of? The popes, from the very first one to the very last one. Again, the quote from Pope Leo XIII, quote, we hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty. Again, the Pope claims to be God Almighty on the earth. Here's another quote. This from Levy and Cossert's History of the Councils. That is a compilation of works recording the acts and decrees of the Roman Catholic councils throughout history. You'll find this quote in volume 14 and column 109. Quote, speaking of the popes, it says, quote, for thou art the shepherd, thou art the physician, thou art the director, and thou art the husbandman. Finally, thou art another God on earth. Unquote. Yes, that's what was stated verbatim at one of the Roman Catholic councils, one of the ecumenical councils of the Roman Catholic Church. Again, he says, speaking to the popes as an authority of the Church, speaking of the popes, he says, for thou art the shepherd, thou art the physician, thou art the director, and thou art the husbandman. Finally, thou art another God on earth. Is that blasphemy? Absolutely. It's the textbook definition of blasphemy. It is the definition of blasphemy taken right out of God's word. That's the only definition that counts, by the way. Another quote from the Extravagantes of Pope John the 22nd, title 14 and chapter 4. Quote, the title, Lord God the Pope, is found within a gloss of the Extravagantes of Pope John the 22nd. In the official decrees of the popes are referred to as, quote, Lord God the Pope. Unquote. Lord God the Pope. Is that blasphemy? Indeed, blasphemy on steroids. Lord God the Pope? And yet, this is the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. To believe otherwise is grounds for excommunication from the Church, and excommunication from the Roman Catholic Church is the same as eternal damnation. The papacy does not only utter blasphemies against the throne of Almighty God, but it enforces those blasphemies as a dogma of the church. Now, here is what I've quoted so many times. This quote is taken from an official bull, an official papal bull, a papal bull being the most authoritative writing that a pope can issue, a papal bull entitled Unum Sanctum. It was issued by Pope Boniface VIII, and it reads thus, quote, "The Roman pontiff judges all men, but is judged by no one. We declare, assert, define, and pronounce to be subject to the Roman pontiff is to every human creature necessary for salvation. That which was spoken of Christ, quote, thou hast subdued all things under his feet, unquote, may well seem verified in me. I have the authority of the King of Kings. I am all in all and above all, so that God himself and I, the vicar of God, have but one consistory, and I am able to do all that God can do," unquote. Did anybody count the blasphemies in that one quote from the papal bull, Unum Sanctum? It is taught in the Roman Catholic Church that to be saved, you must be a subject of the Roman pontiff. You must be a subject to the Roman pontiff, the pope. And he says, I and God are one consistory. In other words, we consist of one and the same thing, one and the same office, God on earth. And he says, I am able to do all that God can do. In other words, I can forgive your sins, or I can bind those sins to you and cast you into the flames of hell. That's official teaching in the Roman Catholic Church. It's dogma in the Roman Catholic Church. You must believe it on pain of excommunication and eternal damnation. When a pope speaks, he is expected to be believed without error, without adding to his words or taking anything away from his words. He is to be believed and obeyed without thought, without equivocation, or without mental reservation. He is to be believed and obeyed as he were God on earth. Now, of course, these are but a few quick quotes of the popes proving they believe they are God on earth. And the author of this page says, I have dozens more on my Words of the Beast page. And he says, what amazes me, if some small cult leader anywhere in the world was to proclaim himself to be God on earth, the authorities, that is, the governments of the world, would snatch him up in a heartbeat. Yet the popes of Rome can proclaim this lie for almost 2,000 years, and no one seems to mind. Did you ever wonder why the President of the United States, the Speaker of the House, all government officials having a private or public office with the Pope or any of his representatives, the cardinals, the bishops, or the priests, regard them as Father or Holy Father or Most Holy Father? How about the other titles of dignity that they give? How about Your Eminence, Your Primacy, Your Eloquence? On and on and on. These are blasphemy. Arrogating to a man the prerogatives and titles and power and authority of God on earth is blasphemy. Claiming that power and prerogative and office is also blasphemy. And we see the government of the United States and every constituent of that office conforming to the command to address the Pope as God on earth. More from this same document. Now, I want to let the listeners know that in preparation for this discussion tonight on Michael's program about blasphemy, I could have spent days, weeks, or even years to prepare, to thoroughly prepare for this discussion. And I didn't have the time. And besides that, I would simply just be reinventing the wheel. These words of the Pope's have been recorded in many, many websites. But for this discussion about blasphemy, I chose a website called remnantofgod.org. That's remnantofgod.org. You can go to this website, as I did, www.remnant, that is R-E-M-N-A-N-T, of God.org. And I went to the upper left-hand corner, and I just typed in the word blasphemy and hit search. And it came up with hundreds of quotes, hundreds of articles about the blasphemies of the papacy. And you can do the same thing. Many websites have search engines. And I recommend this website for this study. I recommend many, many other websites. I don't have time to list them all. But if they have a search function, simply type in the word blasphemy and see what is recorded. And many of them will take these quotes right out of papal bulls, papal encyclicals, official Roman Catholic publications, magazines, and other Roman Catholic websites quoting the popes in their encyclicals and bulls and Roman Catholic canon law. And that's what the author of this website does too. Now, he's going to give us some quotes of popes declaring themselves to be God on earth. This is blasphemy as defined in the Bible by John in chapter 10, verse 33. Here are some of those quotes. Quote, "The Pope is not simply the representative of Jesus Christ. On the contrary, he is Jesus Christ himself under the veil of the flesh, and who by means of being common to humanity continues his ministry amongst men. Does the Pope speak? It is Jesus Christ who speaks. Does he teach? It is Jesus Christ who teaches. Does he confer grace or pronounce a curse? It is Jesus Christ himself who is pronouncing the anathema and conferring the grace. Hence, consequently, when one speaks of the Pope, it's not necessary to examine, but to obey. There must be no limiting the bounds of the command. In order to suit the purpose of the individual whose obedience is demanded, there must be no caviling at the declared will of the Pope, and so invest it with quite another that which he has put upon it, no preconceived opinions must be brought to bear upon it. No rights must be set up against the rights of the quote-unquote Holy Father to teach and command. His decisions are not to be criticized, or his ordinance disputed. Therefore, by divine ordination, all, no matter how august the person may be, whether he wear a crown or be invested with the purple, that is the robe of a bishop, or be clothed in the sacred vestments, all must be subject to him who has had all things put under him," unquote. Now, that's a very lengthy quote, but it is blasphemy from one end to the other. And it is recorded in an official Protestant publication demonstrating the blasphemies of the papacy. It's recorded in the Evangelical Christendom magazine, dated July 1st, 1895. And you'll find it on page 15. And on this website, there's even a link to it. It was published in London by J.S. Phillips. Now, remember, England was Protestant. And this Protestant publication denounced the papacy as Antichrist simply by recording his blasphemous decrees. Now, he says these words appeared in the canon law. Now, remember, Roman Catholic canon law replaces God's holy law. Okay? It's the law of man, a man called the Pope in Rome. Roman Catholic canon law is simply a compilation of all the decrees, all the bulls, all the definitions, and all the extravagant claims that have been made by the popes over the last 2,000 years. Roman Catholic canon law is just the body of law that has been established by the greatest blasphemer on earth, the papacy. And Roman Catholic canon law is simply blasphemy from one end to the other. And not only that, but Roman Catholic canon law, according to the papacy and the Roman Catholic Church, is to be implemented through the civil laws of every land. In other words, all the civil laws of the United States, federal, state, county, and local, are to reflect the decrees of the popes in Roman Catholic canon law. They may use other language, but the meaning has to be the same. So what we have is the civil powers of the world, especially in the United States of the government, adopting Roman Catholic canon law and implementing it through the civil laws of the land. And that makes each and every one of us one who obeys the Pope, one who has been made, without their knowledge, a subject of the Roman Pontiff. In other words, the civil laws of this country, being truly Roman Catholic canon law, have made us all blaspheme against God. You find that difficult to believe? Well, I offer you a video on YouTube right now. It's entitled Vatican Control Through Civil Law. Vatican control through civil law. You simply go to Google and click on YouTube and type in the title, Vatican control through civil law, and watch the video. It's not a very long video, but it's the information contained in it is vitally important to each and every human being in this country, whether they be Christian or otherwise. I recommend that video to virtually every American, no matter what their faith. Vatican control through civil law by Richard Bennett. And Richard Bennett was an Irish Roman Catholic priest for 22 years. And he knows Pope speak. He can read papal bulls and encyclicals, even in the original Latin. He can understand not only the words, but he can understand the intent and the portent and the intent of the papacy in those words. And having been gloriously redeemed from that papal blasphemer and saved by the blood of the precious saving blood of Jesus Christ, Richard Bennett is now telling the truth about Roman Catholicism, about Roman Catholic canon law, and about the civil governments of the world. Again, Vatican Control Through Civil Law by Richard Bennett. Watch that video. Now, here's a quote. It says, these words appear in the Roman Catholic canon law. Quote, to believe that our Lord God the Pope has not the power to decree, as he has decreed, is to be deemed heretical. Okay? If you don't believe the Pope, that the Pope, or rather, according to their teaching, the Lord God, the Pope, has the right and the power to make decrees affecting every man, woman, and child on the planet is to be deemed heretical. In other words, you're a heretic if you do not believe the Pope has the power and the office and the prerogative and the jurisdiction and the divine right authority to dictate to every living creature on the planet. Okay? If you do not believe that, you are, according to Roman Catholic canon law, a heretic. And according to the Fourth Lateran Council, back in the 1200s AD, the Vatican proclaimed that once a man is determined to be a heretic, there is no redemption unless he renounces his heresy. And in addition to that, all heretics are subject to the pain of death. Not only can the Vatican declare them heretics and that they be killed, the Fourth Lateran Council decreed that it is not a sin to kill a heretic. More than that, it is a meritorious work. In other words, you gain grace in the Roman Catholic Church if you kill a heretic. One who has been proclaimed by the papacy or the Roman Catholic Church or a high-ranking Roman papal official, once being proclaimed a heretic, it's no sin to kill you and to confiscate your property and your children and your wife and the whole nine yards. And not only is it not a sin, it is an act of faith. It's divine worship to kill a heretic. That from the office of the papacy, the biblical, historical, and prophetic antichrist of the Bible, the blasphemer of all blasphemers. Okay, this is why the Lord God in heaven defines blasphemy as a sin, because the papacy is the enemy of the throne of heaven. And the words of the popes verify it. Out of his own mouth, the popes of history have proclaimed themselves to be antichrist. Okay? They say that they preach Christ, but yet they say they are the replacement of Christ on earth. And when you get right down to the full study of this, they deny that Jesus ever existed. There may have been an historical Jesus, but it's the popes who occupy the office that is given to him. That's how far the blasphemy goes. And any church, any believer who says that Jesus has not come in the flesh, the same is a blasphemer. And the papacy is the blasphemer. And the very words of the popes prove it. Now, another quote, Father A. Pereira says, quote, "It is quite certain that popes have never approved or rejected this title, Lord God the Pope, for the passage in the gloss referred to appears in the edition of the canon law published in Rome in 1580 by Pope Gregory VIII. So Roman Catholic canon law, even though the popes, they say, have never either approved or rejected the title, in Roman Catholic canon law, the Pope is referred to as Lord God the Pope. Okay? So that while there may be no official approval or rejection by the papacy of that title, that's how he's referred to in Roman Catholic canon law. That's the law of the church. Another quote. It seems that Pope John Paul II now presides over the universal church from his place upon Christ's cross. Unquote. That quote was taken from Auckland bishops, who says Pope presides over the church, or rather the whole world, from Christ's cross. In other words, it was the papacy that was crucified, right? I mean, how ridiculous. You see how slowly but ever completely and perpetually the papacy keeps turning up the heat on this idea that the Pope is God on earth. And that's what we're faced today in the world, not just here in the United States, but all over the world. And he continues, quote, "In founders and foundresses of the consecrated orders of nuns and priests, we see a constant and lively sense of the Church, which they manifest by their full participation in all aspects of the Church's life, and in their ready obedience to the bishops and especially to the Roman Pontiff. Against this background of love towards Holy Church, quote, the pillar and bulwark of the truth, see 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5, we readily understand the devotion of St. Francis of Assisi for the Lord God the Pope, the daughterly outspokenness of St. Catherine of Siena towards one whom she called Sweet Christ on Earth. Now, all these ancient saints of the Roman Catholic Church who have been sainted by the Roman Catholic Church have been canonized and beatified. These are their quotes. They quote the Pope as being the Lord Pope. And Catherine of Siena called the papacy Sweet Christ on Earth. And continuing, it says, the apostolic obedience and the entire cum ecclesia of St. Ignatius Loyola, that is the founder of the Jesuit order, and the joyful profession of faith made by St. Teresa of Avila, quote, I am a daughter of the Church, unquote. We can also understand the deep desire of St. Teresa of the Child Jesus, quote, in the heart of the Church, my mother, I will be loved, unquote. These testimonies are representative of the full ecclesial communion with the saints. Founders and foundresses have shared in diverse and often difficult times the circumstances. They are examples which consecrated persons need constantly to recall if they are to resist the particular strong centrifugal and disruptive forces at work today. A distinctive aspect of ecclesial communion is allegiance of mind and heart to the magisterium of the bishops. In other words, the magistry of the bishops. An allegiance which must be lived honestly and clearly testified to before the people of God by all consecrated persons, especially those involved in theological research, teaching, publishing, catechesis, and the use of the means of social communion. Because consecrated persons have a special place in the Church, their attitude in this regard is of immense importance for the whole people of God, unquote. So what this says in total is that the Pope is God on earth and that the saints of the Roman Catholic Church, those who died and were members of the Roman Catholic Church and thought to be divines in the Roman Catholic Church and who were beatified and canonized by the Roman Catholic Church as saints, have likewise referred to the Pope as Sweet Christ on Earth, the Lord Pope, and also that the leaders of the ecclesiastical societies, the Jesuits, the nuns, and all the religious orders, the entire ecclesiastical communion of the organization of saints and founders and foundresses of the orders of monks and friars, and even the ecclesial communion of the magisterium of the bishops. In other words, the entire organizational structure of the Roman Catholic Church, from the Pope right on down, hold a divine office. They have a divine prerogative. They have divine power. And they are all singly and collectively to be worshipped as God on earth because they all carry the sanctity and the office of the Pope. They're authorized by him. and they are to be obeyed by the whole people of God, whoever they may be. And this quote was taken in the apostolic exhortation on the consecrated life and its mission in the church and in the world. And it was published March 25th, 1996. Now, here's another quote. It seems that Pope John II now presents, oh, that's a repeat of another one. I'll skip that one. Here's another quote. The Pope is of so great dignity and so exalted that he is not a mere man, but as it were, God on earth and the vicar of God, unquote. This is from Ferraris' Ecclesiastical Dictionary. It's a Roman Catholic dictionary. You can make reference. You can look this up for yourself. And as with all these quotes, the citations are given so that anyone can look them up and verify the truthfulness of the claims made by the author of this website. And he should know, he was once a Eucharistic minister in the Roman Catholic Church, and he converted to Christ, and he's exposing what he knew of the Roman Catholic Church and what he has learned since he left the Roman Catholic Church. Now, here's another quote, this one on the authority of the councils, Book 2, Chapter 17. It's another book that records the acts and decrees of the popes and the councils of the Roman Catholic Church. Quote, all names which in the Scripture are applied to Christ, by virtue of which is established that he is over the church, all the same names are applied to the Pope, unquote. Okay? Full of names of blasphemy, right? The Scripture says it's had a name written. Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And full of the names of blasphemy, written all over it. That's the Roman Catholic Church. That's Roman Catholic canon law. That's the decretals of the popes. That's the extravagantes of the popes. That's the bulls and encyclicals of the popes. That's the publications of the popes. That's Roman Catholic canon law. Look, there's no place on earth in the history of the world where blasphemy has been practiced as a matter of religion, as a matter of salvific dogma, than in the Roman Catholic Church. Yes, we may find examples of blasphemy all over this world, but they're all found at the same time and collectively in one institution on the planet, and that is the papacy, the office of the popes. The Pope is of so great dignity and so exalted that he's not a mere man, but as it were, God and the vicar of God. That's from their own encyclopedia, their own dictionary. And that in the Scriptures, all the names that are applied to Christ by virtue of his establishment as head over the church, all these same names are applied to the Pope. He's a counterfeit Christ. He has blasphemed the name, the office, the power, the prerogative, the jurisdiction, and the very throne of Almighty God. That is blasphemy. Here's another quote. This from Antichrist Pope Pius V, and by the way, they're all antichrists, all each individually and all collectively are the man of sin, the son of perdition, the little horn of Daniel, the biblical, historical, and prophetic antichrist of the Scriptures. Don't look anywhere else for antichrist than the popes of Rome, and for proof, just take the words right out of their mouth. Look at their writings. Look at their canon laws. Look at their bulls and decretals. Here's another quote. Pope Pius V quoted in Barclays, chapter 27, page 218. Quote, the Pope and God are the same, so he has all power in heaven and earth, unquote. Another quote, the Pope is, as it were, God on earth, sole sovereign of the faithful of Christ, chief of kings, having plenitude of power, unquote. In other words, his power is limitless. This quote's taken from Lucius Ferraris in his Prompta Bibliotheca Canisi, and anybody can look it up for themselves. Another quote, the Pope takes the place of Jesus Christ on earth. By divine right, the Pope has supreme and full power in faith, in morals, over each and every pastor and his flock. He is the true vicar, the head of the entire church, the father and teacher of all Christians. He is the infallible ruler, the founder of dogmas, the author of and the judge of councils, the universal ruler of truth, the arbiter of the world, the supreme judge of heaven and earth, the judge of all, being judged by no one, God himself on earth, unquote. Now guess where I took that blasphemy of blasphemies? This comes directly from the New York Catechism. This is what is to be studied by every Roman Catholic, the Catechism of the Roman Catholic Church. And that quote was taken from just one of those catechisms, the New York Catechism. If you have a copy of it, just look it up for yourself. Now, writers on the Roman Catholic canon law say, quote, the Pope and God are the same, so he has all power in heaven and in earth, unquote. That's included as a quote from Barclay, chapter 28, page 218. Another quote, Pope Nicholas I declared that, quote, the appellation of God, in other words, the name God, had been confirmed by Constantine, that is the Emperor Constantine, the pagan Roman Emperor Constantine. It had been confirmed by Constantine on the Pope, who, being God, cannot be judged by man. Okay? So in official Roman Catholic documentation, it was Constantine the Great, they call him, a blasphemer himself who held the title Pontifex Maximus, the head of the pagan Roman Empire, simply took his office and presented it and applied it to the Pope. Okay? He called the Pope God. That's what this says. Quote, the appellation of God, in other words, the word appellation is not understood by many people. The appellation of God, in other words, the name of God, had been confirmed by Constantine on the Pope. So the Pope, Constantine made Pope God, right? That's what it's saying. Who, being God, cannot be judged by man. So the popes are gods, and they can judge every man, and no man may judge him. Are you comprehending now what blasphemy is? How does that compare with the almost universal belief among Christians today that blasphemy is merely the use of Jesus' name as though it were a curse? They haven't told us everything, have they? And they've left out the very most important definition of blasphemy. That which comes from God's word alone. And it applies most perfectly to only one entity on the planet, the papacy. I call the Pope a nuclear-powered blasphemer. That's what he is, both figuratively and literally. It is the papacy who controls the militaries of the world and all their weaponry, because he has the divine right to rule all over this world. And he may judge and punish and kill, and no man may offer a resistance against him. No one may make a claim or a protest against him. He is indeed a nuclear-powered blasphemer. And if there's any one of you out there that has said, no, Tom has just gone a bridge too far, I beg you just to keep it in the back of your mind. And as more and more throughout your life and your studies and your research, you will discover that the Pope is a nuclear-powered blasphemer. You can disagree with me now, but the facts on the ground defy that disbelief. The facts on the ground defy your disagreement with that assertion. Pope Nicholas I declared that the appellation of God had been confirmed by Constantine the Great on the Pope, who, being God, cannot be judged by man. The Pope is of so great dignity and so exalted that he is not a mere man, that he is, as it were, God on earth, sole sovereign of the faithful of Christ, chief of kings, having plenitude of power. That's a repeat of a previous one. The supreme teacher in the church is the Roman pontiff. Union of minds, therefore, requires complete submission and obedience of will to the church and to the Roman pontiff as to God himself. That's a quote from another Antichrist of history, Leo XIII, on the chief duties of Christians as citizens. And you'll find it in the encyclical letter of that title, dated 1890. Here's another quote. God separates those whom the Roman pontiff, who exercises the functions not of a mere man, but of God, dissolves not by human, but by divine authority, unquote. That quote was taken from the decretals of another historic antichrist of the Roman Catholic Church, Antichrist Pope, Antichrist Pope Gregory the Ninth, Book 1, Chapter 7.3. Another quote, hence, the Pope is crowned with a triple crown, as King of heaven and of earth and of the lower regions, that is, hell itself, unquote. That from Lucius Ferraris, again, from Prompta Biblicotheca, 1763, Volume 6, under the article entitled Papa II, page 26. That's right, the popes wear a triple crown. It's called the tiara. Tiara means triple crown, and it does have three crowns on it. It is the large bullet-shaped, jewel-encrusted bullet-shaped crown that the popes normally wear at state functions, or to a lesser extent in these post-Vatican II days, but before Vatican Council II. The popes wore that crown during their coronation. When they were first made pope, the first vestige of honor bestowed upon him was to seat that huge bullet-shaped gold, silver, and precious stone-encrusted crown upon his head. And it has three crowns on it. The top one represents the Pope's authority over heaven, the very throne of God, over the earth, God's footstool, and of the lower regions. This is where we get purgatory from the Roman Catholic Church. So the Pope is all-powerful over heaven and earth and the underworld, hell itself. That's the official belief and teaching of the Roman Catholic Church and of the popes, that he is as the king of heaven and of the earth and of the lower regions. Another quote, this from what is referred to in the Roman Catholic Church as the angelic doctor, Alfonso Liguori, a Roman Catholic divine, and one of the greatest saints in the Roman Catholic Church, revered by everyone. His works are still extant. Alfonso Liguori, in his Dignity of the Priesthood, quote, Innocent III has written, quote, Indeed, it is not too much to say that in view of the sublimity of their offices, the priests are so many gods, unquote. And this is just simply building upon the premise that the Pope is not just King of Kings, but Lord of Lords. That the Pope is Lord of Lords means that he is Lord over his entire house, and all of his priests are little gods under him. Okay, that point is made in many official Roman Catholic documents. Another quote, the Pope is not only the representative of Jesus Christ, he is Jesus Christ himself, hidden under the veil of flesh. That quote taken from Catholic National Magazine, dated July 1895. Here's another quote from Antichrist Pope Leo III in his encyclical letter dated June 20th, 1894. And by the way, these encyclical letters don't have the power and authority of Roman Catholic canon law or a papal bull, but they do reflect the official teachings of the papacy, and it's just a matter of, publication in the Federal Register of the Roman Catholic Church, that is Roman Catholic canon law. In other words, they are Roman Catholic canon law, but stated in a less powerful document. Listen, an encyclical letter, if it is based on Roman Catholic canon law, then it is law. It's canon law, even though it's included in an encyclical letter. An encyclical letter is written and issued by the Pope to the faithful, that is, every Christian on the planet. Anyone who calls himself Christian, anyone who has been baptized in water, is ministered to through these encyclical letters. And it is the pastor's responsibility to teach according to the teachings of these encyclicals. Here's the quote. We hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty. Have you had enough blasphemy for one day? Have you had enough blasphemy for one lifetime? You find it all in the words of the popes. There is no greater demonstration of blasphemy in heaven or earth than the papacy itself. No one even comes close. You think God's trying to tell us something? I do. And I believe him. Thanks for listening. My name's Tom Fress. I'm the regular host of Inquisition Update, heard Monday through Friday on FirstAmendmentRadio.com. You may contact me with email, questions, comments, criticisms, if you like. I get to all my email eventually, at least those that require a response. And I appreciate your time, your patience, and your understanding and your attention to this matter. And thanks for having me, Walt, and thanks for having me, Michael Adams. Again, my name's Tom Fress, Inquisition Update. I'll see you next time.